down deep someplace in his soul, and he finds things from the African-American culture, from the South, from his grandparents, from people he's known in his childhood.
Athens is a kind of, at least at the time period I was growing up, it's a college town, but in many ways, especially for black people in a certain neighborhood, certain areas, and for a lot of whites also, there was a very rural aspect to it. My grandfather had a hog pen right in the middle of the city. And, you know, I would go with him as a kid, you know, and play with the little piggies and all that kind of thing. And in our backyard, my grandparents' backyard, there was a smokehouse and all of that. People would come over on Sunday afternoons or whatever, and, you know, the washtub organ would be played, or spoons, playing spoons on your thighs and then on the chest, which I was never able to get down or understand how that worked. And, you know, playing spoons on a washboard itself, which in Zydeco music, you still see that in Zydeco now, except now they use, is, I think it's made of aluminum now, the washboard pan that they use, but the spoons are still played. And so to me, it's kind of like all of that goes into the blues, and as far as my family aspect, or it's just that whole connection to the earth. Because the blues is a music made primarily by people of an agrarian nature. You know, you lived off the soil, you hunted, you caught what you needed to eat, you grew what you needed to eat. Heated up, you know, and we're out and we're moving about, and the air is just thick with the spirituality, the movement, and it's not just about going out, you know, now you go out to a club to dance, you're going out to have fun and shake your tail feather and all that kind of thing, but then it was, yeah, I'm going out to have fun and shake my tail feather, but I'm also going out to commune, and you're communing with nature, you're communing with the spirits, you're communing with the music, everything is constantly moving, turning, and evolving. I was pushed towards being an abstract painter, and I don't have, if anybody wants to do it, that's fine, but that's not where my head was geared towards. And so I lost interest in it, got out of college, spent a little time in Uncle Sam's Army, and, you know, got out, and, you know, just went in my early 30s, I guess I got fired from one job too many, and there was a painting that I had started on about 5 years before, and I looked at that painting, and, you know, that same year my father had died, and, you know, I was going through some kind of emotional stuff. And I looked at that painting and I said, let me just pick a brush up and see what I can do with this. The next summer, I started working as a muralist, working with youth. And murals were something that always intrigued me because from the viewpoint of what I knew of murals, I didn't think of the Sistine Chapel. I thought of Diego Rivera, I thought of Charles White, John Biggers, and, you know, artists like that, where the murals had a social context to them. A lot of my earlier works were in-your-face social politicism. And I thought, you know, people might like this, but they're not going to want to buy it and put it on their wall because they don't want to have to come home and see this on their wall. And, you know, sometimes they just want to come and look at something that's going to give them some peace.
Tell me why.
but at the same token, if you look at it and you think about my whole approach to it, is telling that story of people that made this music, which means that if you're telling the story, I can only give you a little bit of the story. That means you have to delve deeper into the story and say, well, okay, you know the time period, you know that this is black folks, you know that this is America, you know that this is primarily the South. There are pieces of these that allude to racism, Jim Crow, and it doesn't take too much of a genius to look at that and say, I like that. You know, I've had people look at it and said, you know, I like his work and I like this, but it makes me think too much of what we went through. What I wanted to do was to show a young woman who was had a strong physical presence, but I also wanted to show her relationship to her, I guess, elders or ancestors or family lineage, and to make an homage to all the black men that served in some sort of way in the U.S. military by wearing the kepi, the gun belt, the boots. And the boots are too big for her. She stuffs them with cloth or whatever in the toes so that they fit her feet and that kind of thing. But she keeps them in here with her.
I'm going home, the Lord. I'm going home. I'm going home, the Lord. I'm going home.
My baby sister's crying. My baby sister's crying.
The principal character is Mud Paul Willie, and we basically see the Chittlin Circuit through his eyes. He's telling the story of the Chittlin Circuit, and it revolves around his travels. Mud Paul is like a composite of the quintessential blues man, particularly from that era. He, you know, roams around, he hobos, gets on trains and the paddle wheel boats and go upriver, going from Mississippi to St. Louis, or and even went up to Chicago and that kind of thing. He has a very good friend who I call Critter Getter. And Critter plays the quills, or what most people commonly call a pan flute, which he makes himself. He also plays harmonica. Critter is a grizzled older guy. He's pretty much in all the pieces. He's in overalls. And he's just kind of like the wise old sage, but he's very earthy. Critter is a composite of a lot of the older men I knew when growing up. Principally, two older men I knew growing up that would go hunting and fishing a lot with my father. And, you know, you looked at them and you thought, I don't know what they're going to bring home to eat, but they're going to bring something home.
That represents a lot of years of hard work that I've seen him go through from the day that I met him 10 years ago.
This won't ever be finished, but there are different aspects I want to come out, things that, you know, aren't noted a lot in history, you know. And then when you're talking about everyday people in general, no matter who they are, you know, most people really don't pay attention to them.
The church woman was singing a not so holy tune. Preacher man prayed that child won't born too soon, for it was down in that grit field the child was conceived under a harvest moon. She came with bright eyes, a hungry mouth, and the temper of a fool. She could be mean, crazy, hysterically funny. With a deck of cards, she was goddamn cool. Bet you for a bowl of grits, spoon of butter, and a hunk of cheese. Oh, yeah, she was serious about them grits and cheese. One all the time had a string of luck at 99, until a bright starry night, a stranger silhouetted against a full moon backdrop. He stood tall in the saddle atop a coal black steed, trimmed in silver with head held high and eyes of fire. They strode into town. The town folks lined the streets, whispering and gawking as they fell in behind. And then it stopped right in front of that grit gal saloon. She sat at a table laughing wildly as she won another hand. He slipped off his animal, quiet as night, smooth as silk and cunning as a cat. He strutted inside. Their eyes met, the room quieted. Moon dropped, the sun rose, the grit gal, wild eyes a-glazing, shook hard, yelped loud, and bit deep. The stranger roared, and all of nature got quiet.
I thought I heard that kissy when she blow.